Welcome to Management 280 Organizational Behavior offered by Harper College. My name is Dr. George Machaki. This quick overview of Chapter 13, Power, Influence, and Politics, Organizational Survival Kit, is tied in with an online class that I'm teaching, or face-to-face class that I'm teaching. This week we're going to be talking about Chapter 13, Power, Influence, Politics, and Organizational Kit. Okay, what do you need to know? An interesting chapter here. Okay, power. There's nine generic influence tactics. If I'm looking how I influence individuals, or how individuals are influenced, either through an organizational perspective, training my management, or how an organization influences individuals, and I also have to look how do my employees influence my managers or my organization. So these are the nine ones that you should be at least familiar with. Let me move over here. You have more than enough, you can see it. Rational, persuasion, convincing, logical. A lot of companies will use the logical approach. Here's the best way. Here's why you should do this act or this activity. The other one is basic inspirational appeal. When we come up with a new product or something else, or a new concept, or a new item, or a new thing within the company, we try to build that enthusiasm. So, hey, we could do this. We got a new product. We got a new customer. We got a new way of looking at it. So that's an inspirational appeal. And this is also used not also by the company, is used by the company, but also by managers and sometimes by individuals. We want to try to use that that emotional consultation is usually what I like using when I deal with individuals to consult. I will give participation, and I'm only looking at team building and having teams. Basically, it's to use the consultation type of approach. I get everybody involved and get their information so they all have input in there. The next one, ingratiating, is basically getting someone in a good mood before asking. We all know that. Whatever we want, our spouse, our loved ones, our father, mother, or whatever, we try to get them in a good mood, or even a supervisor. What mood are they at? And companies are also looking when they send messages out that we have the communication chapter 12 and communicating with people. Is what is the right timing to bring good news out, or what is the right timing to bring non-good news out? You know, and being friendly, helpful, personal appeal, using friendship and loyalty, and we'll get that into when you look at the five different power of influences. Exchange. Communication, basically, I mean, if I'm looking at influences, express and implied promises, okay? Coalition tactics, getting others to support your effort. So that's one way to influence people. If I understand the informal people, or the decision maker, if I could convince them, or at least let them hear my side of the story, I have a better chance of getting them involved. And we learned from the communicating in the digital world, we could do that through Facebook, through email, through blogs, or any other thing. Pressure. Like it or not, one of the pressures that a company has is I can force you to do something, complying and making this system demanding compliance. That's something that the government a lot of times uses. Either you do this or you get fined, or you do this or don't do this, you don't get fined. I don't like using pressure, but pressure is a very effective way to influence people. Some people will go because I can convince them with all these other ones, but some will still not change. They say, hey, no, until I say you either do this or you lose your job or you get fired or you there's a penalty involved in that. Now, legitimate tactics is because I have the authority, so I can influence you because I'm the boss. You have to listen to me. I'm the instructor. You may not like some of the things, but you have to follow organizational rules and policy. These are the ones that you have to be focusing on from this perspective. Now, three influence outcomes. If I use pressure or anything other than pressure or enhancement, you know, to force someone to do this, I basically just get commitment. When I get commitment, all they're going to do is just to meet my goals. What I'm trying—I mean, I want them to commit to it and meet my goals and take that extra step. Okay, so they follow initiative, persuasion, and to pursue the common goal. Commitment's good. Compliance is reluctant to the agreement. Excuse me. These here, if I. Using just pressure and force, they're just complying. They're doing just enough to do what is required. And sometimes that is. A lot of times, if I look at my you know, a certain law, I have to do, I just comply. I don't do more than I have to do, just a compliance. I just meet the rules and regulation, and that's all they do. Okay, so compliance, from a company's perspective, you want people to comply to certain policies. I want it to go above and beyond, but I understand that sometimes certain policies may be unfavorable, and all they're going to do is comply to them. Okay, now resistance. Now, sometimes we outcome is people are going to try to resist. Employees are going to resist. Even managers within the company are going to resist. So they may be stalling, not give the information on time, or outright reject, I'm not going to do it, or they become unproductive by arguing. And that basically is one of the influences, one of the outcomes is through my tactics to get them to do something. Now, build better jobs or of influence and persuading people. Liking. Here's what happens. If an individual likes the organization, or a lot of times you may not like the organization as much as you like the manager or the first line supervisor. So it's important to have the key individuals in there. If I like someone, I'm basically tend to if I tend to like those I tend to like those who like me, okay? So if I like that individual because he or he she has the same kind of personality or whatever, I will be easier for me to be influence that person. So basically building a rapport with people who you would like to influence. That's the one thing. That's a good way of getting a job. Through a job interview, find something in common with the person. So if you're on either side of the interview process, if I can make that connection, the first few minutes to make that connection, if I feel comfortable with that individual, I'm a lot more open to trust that individual and communicate and to find out more about the individual. I'm listening better. Receptory is basically individuals generally express powerful pressures to reciprocate. So basically, if I give you something, I want something back in return. Norm, the basic norm is if you offer to do something for someone, that individual feels compelled to do something for you. So if I give someone some time off with pay, they basically may do some work for me without pay. Okay, it's a two-way street. Belief that both good and bad deeds should be repaid in kind, in a virtual universe. So, if you look at the old proverb, you get what you sow. So if I'm sowing good things to individual, I get good things back. If I'm sowing negative things, I get negative things back. Okay, social proof. People tend to follow the lead of those like themselves. Basically, all it says request comes from you. Two level. Now here's what you look at social. If I get a request from someone two levels up from me, and everyone else is basically following their request, I, like my peers, I almost likely will comply with that individual. Role models. You follow the lead of people you want to emulate. So if there's someone I like, if I like President Obama and I want to be like President Obama, I try to have his mannerism. If he says something, I will try to, I will be influenced by him. You know what I mean? So he doesn't have to pressure me or anything else. If I respect my boss or my peer, that will work well because the role model fits my role model. Consistency. People tend to do what they are personally committed to. How is it that the foot in the door tactic works, that they have adopted a position of commitment, committing themselves to a course of action? Okay, so basically consistent. Be consistent in your in how you persuade individual. You know, a lot of people are more participative. They use all these other ones up in here before to use pressure. Some are always using pressure negative. Don't try to avoid it. But some people, that's the only thing that makes them that will influence their course of action. Okay, authority. Like it or not, I'm the supervisor. I'm the teacher. I have the authority. Some people may not like my graded form. They may not like this kind of a concept map. But when you get in that position, you could change it. But as long as I'm in the position, I have the authority. You have to. It's part of the learning. You have to follow along the suit. You know, example in a hospital patient, and here's one thing you have to look at authority. And this is a good example that the author looked. In the hospital, patients will listen to their doctors, but they are much less compliant with their physical therapists or the nurses because they don't think they have the same authority or the respect or knowledge, for lack of better words. Okay, a scarcity. People influence items or information that have limited availability. Favorite tactics for salespeople, if I'm looking at to influence someone, persuading them, hey, this is the last model, you take it and it's gone, the sale's gonna be gone. And it's no different than you utilize the same kind of approach within the business organization. Okay, five basic power, reward power. You know, I can reward people like that. You know, this is all tied because of my level of authority. Coercive power, because I could punish you, all right? Legitimate power, I am the supervisor or the manager or the lead. Expert power, because I have expertise. I came out of the construction, I came out of the engineering, I came out of sales, I came out of customer service. I automatically, they look at me I may not have any of these, but I got that expert power. Or they have to be also your informal leader. He or she's been there longer, so you have to understand it's a power or base that basically could influence someone else. Okay, so I've got that reverent power, obtaining compliance, charisma. Some people just got the charisma. They just something about them. I like them. They're just a very personal individual. I would follow that person. And you could look at some of the religious leaders. You could look at Gandhi. You could look at Sister Teresa. I was trying to, there's a lot of other. What do you call it? People that have the charisma that you would basically follow the individual. So research found expert and reverent power have generally a positive effect, reward and legitimate, but a slightly positive effect, coercive power, slightly negative effect. If you as a manager or as a company, if you have all of these, if you believe in all of, you have all of these powers, you're very strong. If you only have these two, okay. Better than nothing, right? But you still, you're not as effective. So you try to have the expert power and everything else under evolution, authoritarian, influence sharing, power distribution. All these is where power is going to influence. And I think we're more of power distribution and power sharing, all right? Not as much as authoritarian and influencing the power. Okay, so we have that on that side. Let me move over to this side. And we're going to come up here. Participative management. Going forward, where are we at in most organizations? I have to set up the influence in politics, which I can't get rid of, the influence of my management and everything else, that is a more, that the people I'm hiring and all the systems and everything else, that is a participative management. I set goals, the team works at solving problems, making changes in the organization as a group. Autonomy, and if you look at what's happening in, what do you call it, in Egypt, going with all that, you know, the president was removed from office by the military. I'm not saying the coup or everything else, but that's not it. What's happening is he was in power and he wasn't a participated, and they were looking, instead of an autocratic type of a leader, they're looking more for one that would share the power. And once he started not sharing the power, the people rebelled. And the same thing that would happen on a smaller scale could happen with an organization and a culture. I just used that because it's something that you could tie in how that power, autocratic type of power, may work in some cultures and other cultures. After a while, you want to have your input and everything else. People want to be involved and be participative. Okay, so a meaningful work and a personal skills and empowerment. Remember, when you look at empowerment that you learned in other courses that you had in management or introduction to business that you've taken with me, you basically have to look at empowerment is different than delegation. I'll explain that real quick. Empowerment is something that's part of your job. You have no choice. You're empowered. You can't take it away. Delegation, I could delegate an authority to you, but if you don't do well, I could yank it out. Empowerment, if you're not empowered, it means you can make certain decisions within certain boundaries. If you are not the one who can make that things, or you don't want to say, I don't want to be empowered, then I basically unhire you. You don't belong in your organization. So I'm hiring people. I'm looking at this person has the ability to be empowered. It means they can make decisions within their boundaries. Okay, so we take care of that. Now, organization politics. Like it or not, politics are in every company. There's politics and family. You know how to get to your mom, your dad. If your mom says nothing, or whoever's an authority in the family, or dad, you go around the thing. So there's politics between brothers and sisters, no different than the corporate world. So definition is intentional acts of influence. Okay, and what happens with organizational politics? Unclear objectives, vague performance, ill-defined decisions, any type of change. All those have an influence with within an organization through politics. It may not be for the best of the company. It could be all self-interest. So you have a network, basically self-interest. Some people or departments want to get over another department, so they're using their influence and you're playing the politics. All right, coalition, group of people for specific issues, and that could be your green movement. It could be your unions. I mean, I'm not saying anything. I'm not saying they're right or wrong. You just have to be aware that those are influencing, that you're making the overall decisions and have influence in which way the organization is going, part of politics, an individual level. I may just be very political. I know how to put the right things in the right individual's ears at the right time, but just so I get promoted or so that it benefits me and nobody else. Okay, frequently political tactics, building a network, a useful concept. I keep on stressing, network's very important, using key players to support the initiative, and basically using key players, you have someone for champion the thing that's going to go. And remember, if I like the individual, I could connect an individual, I have a very good ability of getting my way done. Self-promotion, creating favorable image, right? These are, what a department, what a company does all that, they're praising others. And, that's a political thing. Well, George, you're doing such a good thing, but behind them, I'm talking behind you. In front of you, I know I'm very political. Remember, you can't get rid of politics and family. You can't get rid of it. You have to, and companies understand that, so you have to be able to have policies and procedures and the right individuals to manage the political influence. Okay, attacking or blaming others. That's number one. How do I get somebody else making them bad? I say, what a junky job you do. Not to your face. A lot of times I do it to the grapevine or behind the individual's back. Using information as a political tool. I know something somebody else does, and it gives me something else. Impressional management, favorable, a process by which people attempt to control or manipulate the reactions of others to images of themselves, ideas. Job focus, manipulating information about one job. I'm always the best, a supervisor focus, praising and doing favors for a supervisor. That's one thing you have to be aware of as a manager. Does he really like me, or is he behind me, or he is not? All right. And then self-focus. Self-focus is basically presenting oneself as polite and nice person. And I may be very evil, and I'm not saying that, but some people put that one face in front of the manager, in front of the thing, but they react differently. How to keep politics in your organization, establish formal, and this is where you have to be focused from a company. Make sure you have a formal conflict resolution, grievance policy. Even if I don't have a union, you should have ethics as a filter. What is ethical? What is not ethical? And all people are trained with that. Publicly recognize, reward people who get result. That takes care of it, because there's no politics. You have to show what you did. If you got promoted or everything else, what is your strength? Okay, and use ethics as a filter and recognize people. Okay, so that's one way. And this other thing is just basically for homework, leader skill set. And in this online class, I'm not the adult bully. Do you have adult bullies in school? If there are adult bullies in schools, they haven't been corrected, they become adult bullies in work. It could be an informal leader, could be a team member, and it could be a bully to the manager, to the instructor. So you as a, or you could be the adult bully as a leader, okay? And leader skills, cohesive and everything else. Okay, so we doing pretty good. So this basically, if I'm looking at politics, how do I influence properly? How does the company set up the political or maintain the politics? Yeah, you're going to have some politics in there. Just look at our whole society is set up with a political. We have different political. We have the liberals. We have the Democrats. We have the Republicans. We have all different kind of political politics. And remember, we have different groups, social groups that influence political agenda, and you like it or not, they're involved in there because they either vote or they supply money, and it's no different than a corporation. But as a corporation, I want to get the best product and make sure I'm ethical and provide the best thing so everyone is treated fairly and appropriately. So I have to understand politics is there. I have systems and processes involved to maintain and minimize the political arena, and every now and then do a check and balance and have different avenues or different processes that individual, if they feel there's too much politics or they feel they're politically left out of a position, that they have a recourse to voice their disagreement, or have a process to say, hey, I really like the way the system is going. That could be through surveys or other things on there. Okay, so that's it for chapter 13. Remember, you can't get rid of the politics. Those of you who are in business, you can do everything else you do as a manager. You could be the best person, but sometimes you wonder, hey, why didn't I get the promotion? Why didn't my process go under? Be aware of the political arena. You have to be politically, if you look at a lot of our politicians, they know how to play the political base. They know which words to say. They know how to influence certain people within their party or within other parties to get what they want. It's no different saying, so this is an interesting chapter. Very good. Good things. Just a quick overview. So when you're reading the chapter, utilize my concept map. You only got the first tier. So just add on wherever there's a plus, add on to your words, and you'll do very well when it comes for reviewing and understanding this and processing this, not into the short term, but putting it to the long term. That means you listen to my clip here, you're listening to everything else, you're writing, you're reading, you're doing the homework assignments and everything else, and you understand the politics and everything else. And once you're in there, you'll throw in the experience in there and you do well. Again, my name is Dr. George Machacki. This is Management 280, Organizational Behavior, Chapter 13, Influence and Politics and Organizational Survival Kit. And have a nice day. We'll see you in